Hey guys, welcome to this month's dispatches. As some of you may know, I've just recently returned from Australia. I was down there for almost 2 weeks visiting collectors and dealers in Brisbane, Sydney, Adelaide and Melbourne. And I have to say it was fantastic. The weather was beautiful and cool because this is the Australian winter. And up here in Hong Kong, this is most definitely the Hong Kong summer. So it's really hot and steamy up here. So it was a relief to enjoy the cool climate down in Australia. One of the important things about going on these trips is I get to meet face to face with the dealers themselves that look after our business in those places. But just as importantly, I get to meet the collectors who actually buy our products. These people have got lots of excellent ideas, a few crazy ones, but lots of thoughts and comments about everything King & Country does, and also what they would like to see perhaps in the future. So over this 2 weeks, I got to meet many of these people, not just in fairly large groups, but often on a one-to-one basis, where we could talk about different aspects of the hobby in general and King & Country and collect in particular. It was really enjoyable. I always enjoy these overseas trips, not just to Australia, but when I get the chance to go to the States and Europe. And obviously for the last 3.5 years or so, because of COVID and everything else, that has all been curtailed. But finally, at long last, the world and ourselves are getting back to normal. So I sincerely hope that I'll be able to do more of this type of thing in the coming months and years as we go on. One of the exciting aspects about this particular trip was that several of the ideas that were presented to me, I had heard about before, but sometimes it's got to be in the right place at the right time. You know, occasionally we're not ready to do something, and other times when this idea is re-presented to you, you think this is the right time to go forward with it. And what was interesting was that one or two of the particular ideas were mentioned not just in one place, but in several of the places down under. And I'm excited about the fact that we're actually beginning to put them into practice. Now, of course, it will be quite a few months before some of these will appear or you'll be notified about them. But I can tell you that the three of the best ideas that come out of this trip are very exciting. One of which we've never done anything like this before. And I'm very excited about it, and I hope you will be too. Anyway, that was my trip to Australia. I'd just like to thank all of the folks that I met down there, both for their help, their hospitality, their friendliness. And what I'd like to say is, if anybody else around the world gets a chance to go down to Australia, take advantage of it. It's a fantastic country, very friendly people, and lots of spectacular cities and landscapes to enjoy. So that's the travelogue over. Let's get down and see what we're releasing this month of August. We'll begin with something that's completely out of left field. And I'm calling this things that go bump in the night. Now, the reason for that is we're talking about one little character right down the front here called Count Dracula. Now, for those of you that are interested, I'm sure most people have heard the name Dracula. And if they haven't read the original book, they've most definitely seen one of the many movies that have been made about this person. Dracula was a fictional character created by an Irish author called Bram Stoker, and he published his book about Dracula in 1897. And not long after he published the book, he actually helped produce a stage version of the story that created a lot of interest. That was launched in London in the same year. But it was not really until the 1920s that film companies began to be interested in the story of Dracula. And in 1921, there was a movie called The Death of Dracula, a silent movie, obviously, and that was actually produced in Hungary. I don't know how popular it was, but obviously someone must have seen it, because 10 years later, in 1931, Hollywood released its very first version of the story, simply called Dracula, starring a Hungarian actor called Bela Lugosi. Bela Lugosi had appeared in lots of other movies, but never really achieved fame and fortune until he played the role of the vampire count from Transylvania. Over the rest of the 1930s and into the 1940s, he starred in a number of sequels to the Dracula story, and very popular. That sort of drifted away for maybe 10 or so years, until in the 1950s, a British film company called Hammer Films decided to resurrect, if that's the right word, for Dracula. And they produced a Dracula movie all of their own. Now, the 1931 version and the subsequent sequels had all been in black and white. However, the 1958 version starred a great actor called Christopher Lee. And he was a very imposing figure, was going to appear in many, many films, including some of Peter Jackson's films in the 2000s. But he made his name in this horror film called Dracula as well. Now, what made it different, of course, in the 1950s was you had living color. And so you got a much more colorful presentation of the character, and lots of gore and blood and everything else you can think of. Very, very popular. Christopher Lee continued to make movies about Dracula, among many other films that he made, well into the 1970s. The figure that you see before you is most definitely been influenced by the Christopher Lee version, but at the same time, there's little throwbacks to the Bela Lugosi version of Count Dracula. So here you can see him standing, looking rather menacing, and about to maybe pounce on his latest victim. He could be doing that, or he could be going for a night at the opera. He's dressed very formally, and he always seems to be addressed. You never see Dracula dressed casually. He's always dressed in full evening clothes with a large cape. As I say, obviously, the reason for that, of course, is being a vampire, it can only appear at night. Vampires could never go out in daylight. That was death for them. Most vampires were supposed to be dead already. However, they came alive at nighttime. So, our Count Dracula is ready for some nighttime activities. So that's him here, little single figure. And I should tell you, or warn you, that we have some more horror story figurines coming out in the not too distant future. Now we jump from Dracula in the movies to three other characters that were actually inspired by a different movie. When we produced our discovery of Tutankhamun, which was for the centenary of the discovery of Tutankhamun's tomb in 1922, we were looking around for other references, and I came upon, or I remembered, another movie from the 70s, in fact 1978, called Death on the Nile, which starred Peter Ustinov, a great British character actor, as Hercule Poirot, and a whole raft of famous movie stars in supporting roles. Now, the film of Death on the Nile was set in 1937, the same year that the original Death on the Nile book by Agatha Christie was written. And we've chosen three of the characters that appeared in those movies to replicate in our little figures here. So let's talk about the first one, Mrs. Ariadne Oliver. Ariadne Oliver was a character that appeared in many Agatha Christie books, and it has been said that Agatha Christie herself kind of modelled Ariadne's character on a little bit of her own, but Ariadne Oliver also had characteristics that Agatha Christie herself wished that she had had. She was full of female intuition, and she'd used that female intuition to help Hercule Poirot solve many of the mysteries he was involved in. So this is Mrs. Ariadne Oliver, dressed in semi-tropical outfit for exploring the mysteries of ancient Egypt and or exploring the mysteries of death in the Nile. Now, next to Ariadne Oliver is this rather tall, slim figure of another character from the movie. And that figure, if I just turn the page, was none other than Miss Bowers. Now, in the movie, 1978 movie, she was played by Dame Maggie Smith. Now, Maggie Smith has been around for decades. She's one of Britain's finest actresses. And in fact, many people will know her through the series Downton Abbey, where she plays the Dowager Countess of Downton. But here, she's playing this rather butch character, wearing a tweed skirt and tweed jacket. Tweed skirt seems a wee bit over the top for the scorching heat of the desert, but we thought it was appropriate that that's how she would be dressed, and in a very sort of manly fashion. Next to Miss Bowers is an even more famous actor and character. Now, if any of you have read the Hercule Poirot stories, they know that he often has a sidekick who's a former British Army captain, Captain Hastings, who assists him in many of his mysteries. Now, for some reason in Death in the Nile, the part was played by David Niven. David Niven, another very famous British actor from the 30s, 40s, 50s, and into the 60s and 70s. David Niven was, in actual fact, a former British Army officer who resigned his commission in the Highland Light Infantry and went off to Hollywood in the mid-1930s, and went from being just another extra on the film set to becoming quite a major star. And in fact, he co-starred with Errol Flynn in two of Flynn's best movies. That was The Charge of the Light Brigade, I think in 1936, and 1938's Dawn Patrol, which was about the Royal Flying Corps in World War I. In the movie Death in the Nile, for some reason, he was upgraded from being Captain Hastings to a character called Colonel Rice. Well, we've upgraded them again from Colonel Rice. We've called him Colonel Niven as a tribute to David Niven himself. And the reason we've done that is because in 1939, at the height of his career, World War II broke out and Britain declared war on Germany. Niven, being a former British Army officer, felt that he really had to return back home from Hollywood and enlist in the army, and that's what he did. And he came back, and first of all, actually intended to join the Royal Air Force. The Air Force decided they didn't want a Hollywood actor. So he used his old army contacts to get himself a commission. And eventually, at the end of the war, had risen from a humble second lieutenant all the way up to a lieutenant colonel. So we think it's only appropriate that we call this character Colonel Niven. After the war, he left the army, went back to Hollywood, and continued to star in a whole series of films. And some of his most famous films are Around the World in 80 Days, 55 Days at Peking, The Guns of Navarone, and the Pink Panther series. That's just a few of the many, many films he made. Towards the end of his film career, he decided, he was a very good writer actually, and he was always telling terrific stories about his life, especially his life in Hollywood, and he was persuaded by friends that he should actually write his autobiography, which is what he did. And he wrote a book called The Moon's a Balloon, which basically told his life and life story from his birth all the way up through his childhood, school, the army, the golden age of Hollywood, and up to the present day, which at that time was the 1970s. He then decided that he was going to produce another book. So The Moon's a Balloon, again, was his first book. And his other book, which I should know, of course, is Bring On The Empty Horses. Now, Bring On The Empty Horses was also semi-autobiographical, but it really focused on many of the stars that he worked with and played with during his years in Hollywood. I recommend both books. They're fantastic, lots of fun to read. He became a very, very, very good writer, and the books themselves were popular and produced and sold in the millions. So, as a tribute to a very good actor, a very good soldier, and a very good writer, we've got our Colonel Niven, and you can see he's very dapperly dressed. He's got his dark blue blazer, he's wearing his straw Panama hat, his regimental tie, and khaki slacks, and white shoes. Very spiffy. So that's three new figures from Death on the Nile that can also feature in our ancient Egyptian Discovery of Tutankhamun series. And there's a few more that are already in the works that will be released later. Now, we're going to jump miles away from all of that to the cold, cold winter of 1944. And what you've got here is what I've called the Winter Warriors. And we've basically got seven little Waffen-SS figures, very much dressed for fighting the war in the cold weather. They're all wearing typical mixed rig, and I'm sure underneath their mixed rig of camouflage jackets or camouflage trousers with field grey jackets, I'm sure they've got lots of winter woolies on as well. But they're all wearing gloves, they're all wearing head scarves to protect them from the freezing cold. And as you can see, they've been given the frosted treatment as well. We've basically got two single figures. Here we've got a squad leader, who's fairly nonchalantly walking along, enjoying a cigarette while he's got his MP40 Schmeisser machine pistol by his side. Just in front of him, we've got one of the Waffen-SS journalists that sometimes accompanied these troops into battle. And they reported back to the Waffen-SS weekly called Das Schwarzkorps, which means the Black Corps. This was produced every week and had stories about what the Waffen-SS were up to, and maybe not everything they were up to, but at least what was fit to print, and would also be taking photographs. So this particular war correspondent is down on one knee taking a snapshot of the advancing troops. The first three figures you see here are an MG34 machine gun team. And again, we've got the team leader in the front. Once more, he's got binos around his neck and he's carrying an MP40 machine pistol. Behind him is the gunner with his machine gun 3-4 and some extra ammunition in an ammo box by his side, while he's got belt of ammunition round his neck ready for use. Behind him is the number two gunner, and he's carrying, I think it's called the Gewehr 43 semi-automatic rifle. So he's providing the backup support. Behind these three is another little two-man machine gun team. This team, the gunner himself is carrying the more modern MG42 gun. Now, the MG42 gun was much cheaper to produce. It was easier to produce, had a higher cyclic rate of fire, was an excellent machine gun, probably one of the best light machine guns of World War II, and in fact was that something that, if you know about the M60, the American machine gun that first came to prominence during the Vietnam War, many of the features of the MG42 were incorporated into the American gun that was released later. And the modern German army still have an updated version of the same gun. Backing the gunner up with a machine gun is his number two. His number two is very well armed. He's got a Panzerfaust rocket over one shoulder. He's carrying more ammo in the box. And on his back is another Cool. No, he's got the K98 carbine rifle across his back. So, seven great little figures. But providing the armoured support here is an earlier released model that we still get a few of, which is the Sturmgeschütz 4 Lange, which was the latest version of the famous Sturmgeschütz. Now, this vehicle, as I say, we've only got, I believe, about 60 or 65 of these in stock left. Great little vehicle, and we're offering a special deal that if you buy all seven of these and the tank, you get it for a very special price with quite a big reduction in the cost. So check that out, if you will. Right, here we are. Two little GIs. Now, we showed these when we showed our latest Battle of the Bulge Americans, I think last month or the month before. And it's called Chow Time, and it's hot food being brought up to the front and being doled out to some of the troops. It's a superb little set. You'll get the kneeling chef with the pot of hot stew and vegetables, and bending down to get his share with his mess tin is this GI, who's got a little carbine on his back, but more importantly, is holding his mess tin, and inside the mess tin, you can see that he's received his first helping of stew and vegetables. Great little two-man set, lots of character in it, and makes a welcome addition to any Battle of the Bulge collection. So from there, we're still kind of in World War II, and we move over to another single figure. This is a second generation version of Il Duce, the Italian fascist leader Benito Mussolini. Mussolini had a fascination with all kinds of uniforms, and it was said that he had more uniforms than most of the generals in his army. When we were doing some research on this figure, we saw that one of the uniforms that we had not produced before was the pearl grey version, with the black shirt, a black tie, and so we thought, well, let's offer that for those that are interested. Superb little figure. We've got him giving the fascist salute, or sometimes called the Roman salute. And again, that's available this month as well. From there, we go into what I'm calling guns and ammo. And that's these two little sets of ammunition boxes and weapons boxes. We've provided two versions, one in olive drab and one in natural wood finish. Again, can be used in any World War II scene or Vietnam scene. Really useful little accessory. Doesn't cost too much, but looks great on a vehicle or just around any scene that you've got where you want to show a little bit of the background to whatever action's taking place. So that's what we've got there. And basically, that's it for this month. Not too many figures, and if you look when you see the retirements, you'll see there's not too many retirements either. It's been a fairly busy month, what with being away for 2 weeks in Australia, but now I'm back and hard at work preparing all of these new ideas that I got from the collectors down there. All I'd like to say is, again, a very big thank you to everyone that I was fortunate enough to meet. Looking forward to getting down to Australia again, and already looking forward to going to the Chicago show in late September this year, and then on to San Antonio, where I hope we'll have a little meet and greet with some collectors down there also. But for the moment, that's the story so far. Hope there's something for you, and hope you at least like a little bit of something of what we've done. Thanks again, and see you next time.